Okay, in chapter 7, part 2, we're going to talk about regulating enzyme function, and we're going to begin by talking about what we can do with enzymes that are already made within the cell. Okay? Now, there's going to be a need to regulate whether or not enzymes work because we don't want all enzymes working all the time. Okay? Eventually, we're going to talk about not making enzymes that we don't work, but in this situation right now, we're talking about enzymes that are already made and within the cell and actually not using the ones that are already there, okay? Versus the ability to use the ones that we've made. Now, a constitutive enzyme is one that is always present in pretty much constant amounts within the cell, no matter how much substrate there is. In other words, this is an enzyme that is sort of continuously needed. It's always made, it's always on, always working, okay? And the amount doesn't necessarily vary that much. But in a regulated enzyme, we can actually turn the enzyme on or off in responses to changes within the substrate. Okay? So how much substrate we have actually helps us figure out whether or not we want the enzyme to be on and working, i.e., if we have lots of substrate, okay? Or if we have very little substrate, then we keep the enzyme from working at all. Okay? So regulated enzymes are going to be turned on and off as needed. Okay? Now, there are a couple different ways to do this. One of them is environmental regulation. Okay? How well the enzymes work are very influenced by the type of environment that the cell is in, because enzymes are proteins. Okay? They can be denatured by things like high heat, low or high pHs, osmotic pressure, so excess salinity, too much salt. Okay? Or too much sugar, and actually regulate how well certain types of enzymes work. So changes in the normal conditions usually cause enzymes to be what we call labile. Okay? It's another word for unstable. Basically, what's happening is that those hydrogen bonds and the bonds that are holding the three-dimensional structure of the enzyme start to destabilize. Okay? Eventually, if those three-dimensional bonds are broken and the three-dimensional structure of the protein is damaged, okay, or changed, the enzyme can be denatured. We remember that the form dictates function when it comes to proteins. Denaturation constitutes a change in the form. Okay? So when the form goes, so goes the function. Now, another way to do this is with what we consider enzyme inhibition. Okay, now inhibitors are extra molecules that will actually control how well enzymes work. Okay, and inhibition comes in two types: what we consider competitive inhibition, where a competitor molecule actually has a shape that is very similar to the normal substrate that would fit into the active site of the enzyme. And instead of the normal substrate actually fitting into the active site of the enzyme, the competitive inhibitor fits there, and the reaction itself is blocked because the substrate cannot actually make it to the active site. Okay? Remember, we have to form that enzyme substrate complex for the enzyme to work. So this is an example of the enzyme substrate complex. You've got to get the enzyme and the substrate together attached to one another. There's got to be binding at that active site. This would be the active site. Okay? Now, if the enzyme is blocked by a competitive inhibitor, okay, the reaction does not proceed. If the enzyme can actually remove the competitive inhibitor, or okay, if the competitive inhibitor is removed by another source, okay, then that opens the enzyme back up to bond with its normal substrate, the reaction proceeds. And in this particular reaction, okay, you see that the substrate is broken. Okay. Now, the other version of this is termed non-competitive inhibition in your book. Honestly, I prefer the term allosteric inhibition. Okay. Allosteric actually means other shape. Okay. This is termed a non-competitive inhibitor because there is no competition for the active site. Instead, the molecule binds to what we consider a regulatory site. So this is somewhere else on the enzyme, okay? And The regulatory molecule, once it's bound, changes the shape of the active site. And we remember that three-dimensional shape is extremely important. And when we change the shape, we remove the functionality of the enzyme. So the reaction itself is blocked because the substrate cannot bind to the enzyme and there is no enzyme substrate complex. Okay? In this particular instance, it's what we term feedback inhibition. Okay? Because the product that is being made, actually excess product, shuts down the production of more product, okay, by binding to the enzyme and being an allosteric or non-competitive inhibitor. Now, the other option we were talking about is controlling the synthesis of enzymes. So instead of controlling the enzymes that are already there, okay, we can control whether or not the enzymes are made. And if you remember, okay, enzymes are proteins, so they get made via transcription and translation. Okay. So we need to be able to control whether or not we actually make certain enzymes. Enzyme repression, okay, is actually responsible for basically turning off the ability to make an enzyme. So in enzyme repression, what we see, okay, is some type of inhibitor, okay, that removes the ability to transcribe or possibly translate the enzyme. Okay. That's what happens when an enzyme is repressed. Now, in enzyme induction, okay, what happens is we remove, okay, we remove these repressors, okay, and apparently we also remove some of the ink from the slide, okay, so we see it here, DNA, okay, to RNA. So we allow transcription and translation to happen. So repressing an enzyme is basically turning off an enzyme that has been being made. So repressing it cuts off the production of the enzyme. Induction, okay, synthesizes the enzymes as needed. Okay, it's turning on the production of the enzymes. Okay. So I always like to talk to people about Pop-Tarts and toaster strudels in this instance. Okay, so if you yourself, okay, are a Pop-Tart addict, it's all you eat, that means you're going to need a special enzyme to digest Pop-Tarts. Okay, we're going to call that enzyme tardase. Okay, so let's say you need tardase to digest the Pop-Tarts. Okay, okay. Now, eventually, someone comes on the news and says they're halting production of Pop-Tarts. Pop-Tarts will no longer be made. Okay. At this point, you have two options. You can starve to death because you just refuse to eat anything but Pop-Tarts, or you can switch over to something else. In my mind, you're probably going to switch over to an alternative food source. So you pick something close to the Pop-Tarts and you go for toaster strudels. Okay. We'll say that you need strudelase, okay, to digest toaster strudels. Okay. Now, if you are digesting Pop-Tarts, do you need to make strudelase? Well, the answer is no, you should have that particular enzyme repressed. Okay? But if you run out of Pop-Tarts and have to switch over to the toaster strudels, what you need to do is induce the production of the strudelase, okay, and repress the production of the tardase. Okay? So bacteria are actually excellent at this. Okay? An example you'll find, E. coli switching from glucose metabolism to lactose metabolism. Okay? So what you'll see is that glucose is the preferred food of E. coli. So they're going to eat it first if they have the option. So what we're showing here, okay, is amount of lactose and amount of glucose and amount of bacteria. So basically we put equal amounts of lactose and glucose into a test tube and then added in a loop full of bacteria. Well, the bacteria are going to start eating the glucose. Okay. And as they metabolize the glucose, the population itself grows. You can see it here, our lag and log phase. Okay. But eventually, a problem occurs, and they run out of glucose. Well, the bacteria are not going to starve to death. There's lactose in the media. But okay, In order to digest the lactose, they're going to have to repress the enzymes that they've been using for making glucose metabolism, okay? And they're going to have to induce, okay, the enzymes you need to digest lactose. Specifically, this one's called beta-galactosidase. It's one of three enzymes that are actually needed to digest lactose. But we get the beta-galactosidase induced, okay, and we suddenly see that the lactose is now being utilized by the organisms, and they have a little slump while they're waiting for the enzyme to be produced, and the bacteria begin to grow again. Okay? They've had to induce and repress enzymes, okay, to switch over between food sources. This is what we mean when we talk about organisms being adaptable to certain situations. There's facultative organisms. Okay? Well, this organism is a facultative lactose metabolizer. Okay. Normally it likes glucose, but it can survive in the lactose if it needs to. Okay. A major bonus to this is that it prevents the waste of energy. Making proteins is expensive. Okay. It takes on average about 2,000 ATP to make a protein. So instead of making all of them at once and then repressing them with competitive inhibitors and non-competitive inhibitors, we're gonna save the ones that we don't really need all the time and make them as needed. So transcribe and translate them as needed to conserve energy.